cast your nets to the other side. That is basically what my theme is today. Last week, if you were not here, I shared some important news, and it takes time for some of what I said to digest. I have preached in August 16th in particular. 23rd was Canon O'Neill. August 30th, I preached again. Labor Day was Tim. The 13th, I did another sermon. On the 20th, I did another sermon. All is foundational to where I believe I'm leading you. It's not just about what I say today. It's got to be put in context. So if you've missed some of these things, I'm encouraging you to go to the website and take a look at the sermons that have been previously preached on this so that you can have a full context. I'm going to unpack and do a brief repetition of what I did last week, just so those who have been here will know. But it's hard for me, as well as it is hard for you with some of the ideas I've shared, because I think about this all the time. This is what I do. And I'm the pastor, and I'm not trying to sell you anything, as I said last week, but I am trying to lead you to say, I think we really need to mark, learn, and inwardly digest some of these things and move together as one. I see it as my job. I see it as part of my calling and responsibility. And there are days when I've said it would have been nice just to leave it all alone and just move forward. But the word needs to be heard. That people, if they are going to be coming to the church, cannot be expected to step into a mature sacramental piety. Even those words to a visitor are actually somewhat creating estrangement. Sacramental piety. For someone who's new to the faith, they would go, what does that, let's get the thesaurus out and look those words up. And so we must be aware of the culture in which we are fishing. But I have shared, when I came back from sabbatical, I had good principles in mind about what was good practice, but I didn't have a template all figured out. And it was in listening, quite frankly, to many of you, that I felt that the Spirit came and guided me to say, this is a direction you need to go. In fact, my original idea was different than what is now being proposed. And I listened to the discernment committee that had been meeting. I've been listening to parish council. I've been listening to wardens and other clergy and talking with them. I appreciate that what I have shared and am sharing may be hard for some of you. When would this change happen in our liturgical practices? I am hoping that it would be rolled out sometime this fall, maybe in November. There are some who have said, just do it now. What are you waiting for? Go. There's people of that temperament. Like, just like, what are you waiting for? I'm so there. Go. And I know that there are others who need to have their hand held a little to just say, okay, let me acclimatize to some of these ideas. And so today at Vestry, if you read the Vestry report, in particular my report, I'm creating an opportunity for a Q&A for us to have some kind of discussion about what I have suggested. In my recap, I wish to say that the idea is that we move to something like, instead of an 8 o'clock service, a 9 a.m. service of Holy Communion. We are a sacramental people. That this is something Jesus commanded us to partake in. It's really not optional for the mature Christian. It is a sign of a healthy church. The ancient church said, tell me, define a healthy church. And Cyprian said, where word and sacrament are properly administered. That's simple. Word, the Bible, sacrament, the bread and the wine in particular. And so we take this most seriously. the Blessed Sacrament. The idea, though, is at 9 o'clock we may offer some music. And Patrick and some of the choir team might well come and sing and lead us in some of that. This is our sacred trust, is what Jesus commanded us to do. But I need to repeat something that I said last week, and I haven't sat on it long enough, but I believe that the sacrament is for the committed in Jesus, not just the baptized, because there's so much in Scripture where Jesus says, if you're not reconciled and done your confession and done your work and get your act together, don't take this. Go and be reconciled with your neighbor. We, the church, historically actually institutionalized that by calling you to private confession. That was the ancient custom. You would take a private confession. You'd get your house in order before you came here. And I think the scriptures tell us we don't need to do a private confession. The Bible tells me it might be good to do a private confession, but it's certainly not necessary, but you still need to do a confession. And as the Bible says in James, it says they confess their sins one to another. Wow. If I have a sin and we had confession today, it's a nice quiet thing I just do. I don't want to reveal everything. But I'll tell you, if I have to go up to Patrick and say, you know, Patrick, I did such and such, and it's not about you, and I haven't stepped on your toes. I'm confessing my sin to you, or any one of you. Is that not scary? Tell me, is that not scary? Nod with me. I don't get there quickly. It's safer to go to a priest. You know, okay, I'll go to the priest, and it'll be behind closed doors. But I'll tell you that if we actually confessed our sins one to another, I think we would sin less. You let things convict you. Father, I haven't been in worship. I have neglected public worship. The ancient church said that's a sin. You might call that a little heavy, but that's the tradition. And the reason you're called to public worship is so that we can grow personally, but also to nurture one another. If you're not there, I understand that, but that's a place you want to get to. That's big league, and we need to be careful. And so we have, this is the what is called a serious and devout calling to Holy Communion. And then, when this 9 o'clock service is over, the coffee pot arrives. Do we have a coffee pot that we can put up there? Coffee in church, a sacramental worship? Probably not. At a public gathering of the community focused on teaching? Absolutely. The fisherman in me says, we need sacrament of coffee, forgive me, that there are many people who are seekers. So last week I shared a story with you about a young man, one of my sons, 27-year-old, who's quite grounded in his scripture. He's in a bar, he's debating with people, and he calls them to worship. You can guarantee that if they've been in the bar the night before and you're expecting them to be at church, odds are they're going to need some Java. And that's the millennials. Let's go back to that coffee pot. I want you to know that in order to make these shifts happen, the work of hospitality among this community is important. You are great at it, but I'm actually going to raise the mark and say we need even more. I was talking to some choir members the other day, and they said, we need a cappuccino machine. And I don't think that's such a bad idea. We have to get used to the idea that the seeker may come in, and one of the most hospitable things they will note is not just your friendly face, but someone offering you a quality cup of coffee and said, you're welcome to bring it in here. What do I do about my furniture? Some of you are concerned. It's called Scotch Guard. Okay? That's we deal with that. But that's the risk of doing ministry. This isn't just to preserve our thing. And then we move to a gentle service of the Word. If we could look at that Holy Bible and recognize that the Scriptures need to be explained to people. Reverend Tim used a phrase that I found helpful. He said, maybe it's what we could call the public service. And public service is the idea that this Word, this Bible, is actually not just for you, but it is for the public. They don't come in and start at this table. They start with us explaining the Word. And then there's a healthy question and answer period. And so the idea is that the service would start at 10:30 instead of 10. Because? Nothing else. We have a 9 o'clock service. Because there are transportation issues. There are subway issues. There are issues about how people get here. The importance of this Bible is that, okay, here's an example. We've been teaching the Good and Beautiful God book. The phrase that keeps coming up is false narratives. Can somebody tell me what a false narrative is? I'm just looking for a short answer, just whatever you think. What's a false narrative? I use that language quickly, but if you haven't been to church, what's a false narrative? An untruth, that's helpful. Just an untruth. This is huge when you're talking to millennials. I don't need a picture of the millennials, but just this. The idea of false truth, that people have ideas about God that are in fact wrong. And I'm sounding pretty dogmatic when I say, how would I know what is right? Isn't that just a personal opinion? And the Christian faith would say no, because of revelation that God has revealed to us and the teaching of the Catholic faith, the Catholic tradition, the universal truths, Jesus has revealed to us. So let me share with you a false narrative that I heard this week that was like a razor to my heart. I wept inside. Seriously. And I said, oh my goodness, you don't know your Bible. But why should this person? Last week, a terrible thing happened in the history of the world. Happens often. But there was, our Muslim friends were going to Mecca. And if you heard, there was a huge catastrophe. Where people were moving across a bridge or something, and they were moving in opposite directions, and the crowd was so large that there was a bit of a stampede. I can't even get my head around how it happened. But some 700 plus people died is the last number I had. I mean, just by good people going to Mecca, I don't know, they died. That's just terrific. I think everybody should do a pilgrimage in their life. You know, it's a Muslim practice. I think it ought to be more emphasized in Christianity. Maybe we should all go to Walsingham or something and do something. But that being said, an official was given a microphone. And that official was asked, you know, what was going on? And he tried to explain what had happened. And then he said, and he was a religious governmental official, kind of blurred in Saudi Arabia. And he said, this was Allah's will. Now, Christians use the word Allah in the Middle East. That's not a uniquely Muslim phrase. What he's saying is that this is God's will. That's a false narrative. So we got a bunch of people who believe in God. The question now is, what do you believe about that God? How do you see that God? Because if we're all seeing that God differently, then we have problems. And a lot of people are rejecting God, the same God that I would reject. I don't want anything to do. Oh, hold on, your narrative is wrong. Now, how can I say that with any, as a dogma, as a deep truth? Scripture, the Word, Luke 13, go look it up. In the middle of Luke 13, just as a footnote to my sermon, I just tell you because you all know the text, he said with a smile on his heart. There in Luke 13, some people come up to Jesus and they said, this tower in a place called Jerusalem, Siloam, a tower fell on some people. 18 people died. And they asked Jesus the question, what sin did these people commit that allowed them to die? And Jesus basically rebukes them, says, false narrative, you're thinking incorrectly. God didn't will some building to fall on people and kill them. It's an accident. Maybe it was bad engineering. I don't know. But do you see where I'm going here? Is that as a Christian, we need to know our narratives correctly. We need to know the Word. And that's why we spend so much time on the Word. And when my son, Ben, is in the pub or you're in a place and you're having a conversation, he says the false narratives are just... It's just like I feel like Muhammad Ali taking punches because I have to correct people. It is staggering what the 20 and 30 and 40 somethings don't know about Scripture. And yet they pontificate at great length about things they know nothing about. Therefore, we must know our Word. And when we bring them, we need a place where the Word can be explained in a relaxed environment. And that's part of what is being proposed. I think that's an important piece. Where the Word, they can hear the Word, they can challenge the Word, where we grow in the Word and ultimately accept the Word. Last week, somebody came up to me and said, I got one major problem with your sermon. I went, okay, what is it? He says, your metaphor, the telephone, you used an old a telephone. He said, that telephone was so not old. That's an old telephone. I should have used one of these. That's where they say, hang up the phone. Hang up the phone. We still say hang up the phone even when we put it down. Some of you don't even put them down. You don't even have a landline anymore, as I pointed out, and I pulled out my cell phone. And then I got mocked because I have an old BlackBerry, and this is a dinosaur. And I'm just saying that this is what we're facing with the culture that is moving so quickly, and it is though we in the church are still working with that. The time has come. And so if I have another image, is that I still sometimes think that we're still dealing with the sundial. I talk to people who don't even use watches anymore. They have a Fitbit on their arm. They measure their steps. I don't need to know what time it is. It's on my BlackBerry or whatever. Okay? I don't need a watch anymore. The culture's moving so quickly. And we have an obligation to meet that culture. And so, as I said last week, it's not just about us. It's about how do you meet a world that needs to hear this truth. And this is the core of why I'm making these suggested shifts in what we're about. I want to share with you one story and then move to Bible, we'll be done. I used the example last week about my son and the conversation, and many of you said that was a highlight of the sermon because it just riveted you. I'm going to share one more story. It's about some people I stayed with in Germany. And there's Carolyn, and this is Sven and Fonny, and we're in Freiburg, and we had a wonderful visit. They're related, they're relatives. And we were able to stay at their home while we stationed, and we go off to the Black Forest, or we cross the Rhine and go and have wine in France and whatever. And we had a grand time, and back and forth. And we were with them, I don't know, 10 days, 2 weeks, I don't know how long we were there. But what was interesting was, is that these are hugely educated people, okay? They both have doctorates from Stanford. He's a research scientist, and she's an ophthalmologist. She does eye work. So she's the doctor, and he's a doctor, and he's doing work on brain and how we perceive stuff. Staggeringly smart, okay? But as we were living with them and coming and spending time with them, we didn't talk about faith because they have no faith. They weren't raised in the faith. They're German, regular culture folk. What we found striking was that in about 5 days, all of a sudden, they would say, could you do prayers at mealtime? And I'm going, you don't believe this. Why would I okay. So I would offer a prayer. And then the conversations started to happen. And I actually am reluctant to start conversations because I'm a vicar and everyone knows, you know, so I just stay away. But the conversations began and they had deep, authentic questions. Stuff they just didn't know. There was one occasion I was so proud of my Carolyn, and she was sharing the faith and she was pulling out Lewis and she was doing stuff. I actually walked out of the room because I said, she's doing a better job, just get away, because they're connecting. Don't muck it up with all your stuff. So just leave, right? But they respectfully said to me, where do we go to church? We need a place where we can meet some clergy like you who could talk about this stuff, or some other believers that we would, and they were actually, if I lived there, they'd be in church. But I guarantee you, if they'd walked into church and I was vested in my robes and we were in full procession and we spent a bunch of time at the Eucharist and whatever and had an 8-minute or 12-minute sermon, they wouldn't be back. They need to graduate to it. It's called stages of faith. And we need to be respectful, especially in a culture that has not had, there's a whole generation that has not had the gospel shared with them. They just don't know things. They're not anti-church. I keep repeating this. Some are. But many, many are not. They want to know, but they need an environment to do so. Give them a cup of Java and let them come in and relax and talk and go home. And then I get my claws on. That was, I didn't say that. And then we talk about them and I explain stuff. And then all of a sudden, I would hope and pray that I tricked them into being Anglican. Did I say that? No, I didn't. But that you would grow into the great depth of what we have, our sacramental piety, because our prayer book is a rich, wonderful tradition. And so that's what that 9 o'clock is about. And a simpler service at the 10:30. I am moved by them. And so I want you to know that this is a risk that I think maybe we need to move toward. So I leave you with this, and I'm going to go to a Bible study. Let's just open up the word for a second. I can't resist. It's in my vestry report. It's from John 21. If you just show a picture of the Bible, that will do for me. This morning we read from John 21. If you have a pew Bible, it's page 88. Now what I'm going to do is something that I often do in a group of 5 or 6. So we'll just pretend you're in a cluster of 5 or 6. I'm going to ask you, you can read along, but I want you to use your imagination. And I don't want you to get too intellectual necessarily. I'm not saying park your brains, but I am saying I want you to imagine yourself in the story. I don't want you to read the story. I want you to imagine you're in the story. The sun is coming up, and it's early in the morning. Afterward, and so I'm going to read the text again, and then I'm going to ask you questions about what strikes you. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, that is the Sea of Galilee. I'm reading from the NIV Bible just to confuse you, sorry. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, called Didymus, that's the twin, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, James and John, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out fishing, Simon Peter told him. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. And he called out to them, children, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. Jesus said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some. And when they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." And as soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, jumped into the water, and the other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish. For they were not far from shore, yet just about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw a fire burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said, "Bring some of the fish that you have caught." Let's end there. Amen. I'm a preacher. I could take that text and talk for an hour. I won't. I want to hear you. Because this is the text your discernment committee landed on. I didn't pick this. And I'm at a discernment committee meeting, and they opened up this text, and it was stuff that came out. So tell me, floor's open. What comes to you from hearing that text? Don't be bashful. Okay, it's about obeying. I like that. Here, the one piece I really like about that is Jesus is a spiritual dude, right? He was a carpenter. Peter's a fisherman. Peter is dejected, and he says, "You know, I don't know what's going on. This resurrected Jesus, I'm freaking out. I'm just going fishing. I'm going back to what I know." And we go back to what we know, and yet Jesus comes and speaks into our world. It's like me telling you how to do surgery. I wouldn't go there quickly. But if Jesus said, "Work on this arm, not this one," maybe you would. You know what I'm saying? Or maybe I came to somebody about, you know, "Here's some financial advice." Don't go to me, go to somebody else. So yeah, I go back to what I know. I'm a fisherman. And Jesus still speaks into their life. Will you let Jesus speak into your life, wherever you are?
Why did he jump into the water? Was he just so happy that he wanted to get to him? Why did he leave everybody in the boat full of fish in? Why did he jump in the water?
Amen. I just think that's beautiful. You get all this fish, and Peter doesn't even look at the fish. Peter's so crazy, he puts his clothes on and jumps in the water. When I go swimming, I tend to take my clothes off to jump in the water. He is so excited, throws his clothes. And the question is, I think there's a preaching point right there. Are you in love with Jesus? I think Peter is just so in love with Jesus that this is my Lord. I just want to be with him. And ultimately, all our church service times and everything we do is secondary to whether, in fact, we love the Lord. I mean, that's what that's about. A couple more. I saw Chris Prentice.
They've been fishing. They've caught nothing. Jesus is saying, "Do this. Go to the other side of the boat." They go to the other side of the boat, and voila.
And voila.
Whole net. I think it's listening to Jesus, following Jesus, his word, that do this.
Okay, I do want to actually end on that, but Scott, you can say
it. Pretty much what I was going to say. You have to fish, go where the fish are. You have to meet people where they are in life, which gets to the point, some of the points you're making here. And it seems to me that Jesus had this lovely way about him, always being able to add to people's understanding of a loving, merciful God, and not trying to take away their history or their previous teachings, but to try to build upon, you know, where they were in their relationship with God.
One of the people from the discernment committee said it. I said, "You know, when I read this text, this guy's been fishing all night. They know how to fish. And they still got nothing." What this personer said was, "You know what's really nice is Jesus is not called us to do something radically different. He says, take your net from this side, put it over this side. I'm not asking you, as Drew would say, I'm not asking you to climb Kilimanjaro. I'm not asking you to do something that you can't do. I'm just asking you to take your net and move it to the other side. I think what I'm suggesting here and what your leadership is doing is suggesting is just a simple little shift so that we may be more effective in proclaiming this gospel. Because ultimately, as our bishop has told us, our primary business is fishing.